Hi everyone, this is the 23rd of February 2018. The markets this week closed positive, and to some extent we called that because there were a couple of intermarket divergences, an important way of looking at the markets that sometimes give you a hint of what's going on. But at the same time, the way this month started, probably a lot of people would not have expected it to end this way. It was a pretty damaging start given the global backdrop and that most of the global indices or specifically the US indices had already retraced, 61%, the Nasdaq almost 78% of the losses that put us closer to a potential rollover. But those markets have actually held up at least for last night. But on the other hand, our own indices actually deviated from the rest of the world. And you actually saw the Nifty continue to slide into expiration, something that has happened after a very long time. Because typically when we see the markets fall, they tend to, at least when the market was rising, it tended to pick up in the final week and, you know, make up for those losses, something that we didn't see happen this time around after a long, long while. We also had, like I said, intermarket divergence, which means that the mid-cap indices were not making new lows along with the Nifty. In fact, even though the Nifty came very close to the 10,300 mark, it didn't break the 10,276 low that it made earlier on in the month, even though the Bank Nifty actually broke that. So we actually got that divergence in these indices, and these near-term divergences can sometimes give you a clue as to a potential market reversal. And it essentially happens because of a rotation between sectors and stocks that allows you to see that. In fact, during counter trend moves, many times what happens is when you're doing an ABC bounce back in wave B, even though the index is not falling to new lows, many stocks break lower because they may not have completed their fifth waves and so on. You get divergences, and that creates a lot of confusion. And when it comes to actually trading, if you're taking an index view to take the stock, you actually get many stops also getting hit. So that is a that's a feature of, you know, up down markets or playing counter trends, that your performance can actually get hit, your strike rates come down during very, very short term trading I'm talking of. But the indications were there that you were getting you're building up for a counter trend bounce back. So we saw that happen this week, and it probably continue into next week now that we've held that. In fact, we've held the 20-week average once more after having held it for the last 6 months. After the recent sell-off, which looks impulsive on most Indian global charts, you wouldn't expect these levels to hold, but you still did, at least this time round. So we'll have to see whether that can happen next time round, because we should be in a much weaker spot if you make a lower top and roll over. And the signs of that should again come from some kind of divergences, because even at the Jan top, I think 17th, I wrote the long short report, the mid-cap indices peaked then and started falling all the way into February. It was only the Nifty that was standalone making new highs. And so once again, the intermarket divergence was apparent and the extreme readings that we saw helped in calling that high. So we've had the sell-off. We're once again looking at the market moving higher. And if you see a loss of momentum, especially in terms of volumes, if volumes continue to fall into the rise and you see a weaker performance of maybe the broader indices versus the frontline indices, those could be indications of the potential rollover. Another one was that I noted in my recent Bitcoin post that, you know, Bitcoin started its wave C down along with most world equities. So that was interesting, because the top that we saw on 28th, 29th of Jan was in tune with the top in even Bitcoin. So if that's a reflection of global liquidity that is moving most markets all together at the same time, then we just saw that happen across assets in this recent sell-off. And so even Bitcoin itself could be an indicator. In fact, this week it actually broke below the channel that I published last week. But again, I think it's held up a bit overnight. So while it may have done the best part of the bounce, it's still probably, you know, forming some topping formation. And that's what I think might also be happening in the US indices. They're either extending their counter trend moves, or they may form some kind of a triangular pattern at the highs. It's a bit early to say. But given the strength, possibly we've already retraced 61%. Maybe we are going to do 78. Maybe we are going to go and test the wave two highs of the fall, which would be pretty interesting, because when you get such a steep retracement and retest, then a lot of people would mostly say that, you know, the fall was temporary. You got a V-shaped recovery and the worst is over. So that's the sentiment I think that you'll start hearing, at least from the US market perspective, in the coming weeks. But what you really need to watch out for, are we really making new highs or not? It's just a deep retracement. It does not really change the indications that, you know, you had an impulsive sell-off. Simultaneously, I think the dollar has also been moving in line with the market. So you had the dollar actually bounce back upwards in the recent market sell-off. And a lot of people started to think whether the dollar is bottoming. It did fall again, made a close to a double bottom and moved up again. So this became the next big debate I'm finding across, you know, media. And I'm not talking about television media. I'm saying the published online media where, you know, people write reports, or, you know, analysts or traders are, you know, making their recommendations. A lot of people are beginning to talk of a bottom in the dollar. However, I still don't see that case. I think this was just a pullback. We've pulled back to the 40-day averages, completed some cycles, retraced 38%, and it looks more to me a setup that, you know, the dollar would start falling again. But like I said, the dollar actually rallied when the market sold off, and the dollar, when it was falling, for a long time had a positive rub-off because of rising commodity prices, which are often a signal that, you know, well, demand conditions are good. So that was getting priced in to the markets and being taken positively, till the point where the losses in the dollar overwhelmed the gains that people thought they were having in the bond market. So the bond market losses, I think, were the main driver. And that, I think, will continue to be the case. So we may have seen last week, in fact, I wrote, I think, at least a couple of times that you could see some kind of a bounce back in the bond market because it was getting oversold. You have positive divergences on the RSI indicator. It's achieved at least equality to its, you know, first wave in the third wave at a smaller degree in terms of the larger sell-off. So essentially what happened last month is when the 30-year bonds broke their March 2017 lows, which they had not done because the 30-year bonds were actually lagging the rest of the bond market. It was, the sell-off was essentially led by the 2-year, the 5-year, and then it caught on to the 10-year, the 30-year was last. And only when the 30-year broke, I think people took note and US equities sold off. Now you're once again at a point where, you know, the bond market is a little oversold. I don't think it's a trend reversal, but maybe over the next week, you get that bounce that I've been looking for. Last night, you've seen bond yields cool off a bit, and that provided impetus for equities also to move up. But that does not change what the dollar is doing now. People often relate the dollar to interest rates, and I've spent, I think, a couple of podcasts explaining again and again that interest rates are not the only driver, and that can be misleading because 2015, 2016, the dollar was up big time, not when interest rates were being, raised, but essentially because of problems in other parts of the world, or rather that Europe and Japan were weakening their currencies officially. So they were actually doing that. But some people started to reason, oh, well, it's Fed expectations of higher rates when they hadn't even raised rates even once. And from the point where they've been raising rates, the first time they did that, we were close to the 100 mark on the dollar index. The second time they did that a year later, we touched 104 and we're down more than 10% from there. So very clearly, that's not the driver. In fact, it's the falling bond market that can be related to the dollar, simply because it's foreign money that moved into US assets, especially the bond market. And this is essentially a reversal of that trade. You may call it the carry trade, you may call it the spread, whatever it is that they're playing on. But the dollar remains in a long-term bear market since it peaked at the start of 2017. So we've completed a one-year bear market. If you've seen the recent video on gold, I explained the same concept. There are cycles that last up to almost 7 years. So you could almost think of another 6 years down on the dollar. But at least for this current leg, which started from I think April or May that the dollar has been falling. We've still, we completed one leg and then we had a counter trend bounce back in August or September. And then we started what is the third wave down of the sell-off. And that third wave itself has not completed five waves. So I think that's where the confusion is as far as at least a meaningful bounce back in the dollar is concerned. And so this bounce that we've seen in the last month or so is of a much smaller degree and not of the higher degree that we saw in September. So I think that it's mostly done and you'll probably see it falling again. You're seeing signs of that in the recovery that you see in oil prices. Most people would have thought oil should have crashed given the heavy positions, but that's not the case. You've just seen a retracement around 38% pulling back to the 20-week average, and then it's bounced right back from there. So as long as you hold that $58 mark, you're either consolidating in what would be a fourth wave triangle, or you're ready to take off to new highs already. Because when you draw a channel around the price of crude or the CRB index, you'll find those charts on Indiacharts have already published them. Then it's taking support at the lower end of the channel. So it could very well start a move to the upper end of the channel, which means you could be at $67, $68 in oil. And if I really project at a much higher degree, which is taking that the initial recovery that you had from, sub 30 to, 45, 50, and then you had a correction. And then if you just take the third wave of that, and if it's equal to the first, you end up with a number which is closer to $80. So we are essentially in a larger degree move up in oil, in the commodities markets. You haven't seen a correction in the base metals, despite the metal stocks having been taken a beating because of the weakness in the market. But most of them are at some support or retracement on a slightly longer term horizon. And metal prices during this period have held up pretty well. Copper still holding its daily averages. Zinc, in fact, made a new high. And so there's no reason yet to believe that has changed. The only segment that is still to participate, although it has, but not strongly, has been the precious metals. The one that has completely not participated has been agro commodities. So this is a long-term cycle. Like I said, if the dollar is going to fall for several years, eventually all the commodity prices catch up. The next one that has to do so is precious metals, and eventually I think that will drive agro commodity prices as well. That's been my view for I think last couple of years. You've had small spikes in some of the agro commodities from time to time, especially you had a big one in sugar. But all of that gave up, and many other agro commodities have been languishing at their lows, making base formations or making those initial impulse waves and just consolidating. You haven't had anything big enough to, get noticed, but they are, so down that, there's actually no downside. The question really is when the upside develops. So I think the next leg in the dollar down should probably be a key driver for the precious metals as well. So those are the trends that we are looking at. Falling dollar, rising commodity prices remain on cards. We are seeing a counter trend bounce in equities, which can continue for a while. And then we'll need to watch when the rollover essentially happens. And I'll continue to update those on with the Indiacharts Insiders daily write-ups. So you can continue reading them. And that's all in this weekend podcast. Thank you.